Hey guys, let's try this. Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, I'm gonna have an activity for you guys. I know, this is to try to wake you up and try to see if your kinesthetic learning is gonna work. So I'm gonna have you all stand up and I'm gonna do some examples of some activities. I thought long and hard about some of these activities too, as you guys are very focused. You guys can do that. In fact, I'll even get on this chair so you guys can see me. If I fall, that would be very bad. I'm going to speak really loud. So, as I was driving here today, I was like, what can we do to really get these teachers kind of out of their seat and awake? Because a lot of thinking is going to happen today. A lot of planning is going to happen today. And we got to get those creative juices flowing. And so I thought, you know, something I used to do as a kid. I think all of us have probably tried some of these things. So I'm going to recreate some of your youthful memories, and you're going to do some things. Number one, I want you to see if you could rub your tummy, pat your head. No, this is no Simon Says. This is just do it. So it looks like a lot of you guys. I could see a lot of you guys have practiced this a lot over time. So I'm going to try another. We're going to up the ante. There's another one. Oh yeah, you have to switch. Okay. So this is, again, if you're able to do both of these, that shows that you have practiced a lot. Now the next one. I'm sure you've seen some of your students do this. Shoot the body, shoot the body, shoot the body, shoot the body. So I'll do it in slow motion. Now, see if you can do it. Raise up your hand if you can do the shoot the body. Oh, I see. Oh, you know, you can tell I had no friends. Because I can only, just, I had friends. All right, here's another one. Okay. One thumb up. One finger up. This is your thumb up and then just finger pointing at your thumb. And then I want you to switch. And then switch again. And then switch. And then try and do it really quick. Good? Wow. Raise up your hand if you can do that one. Because that one seems simple, right? No, kind of?
It works easier.
Okay. So, let me try one more. This one takes a little bit more thinking. It took me a while to do this one. Get one hand to go clockwise. Now, the other arm is going to go the opposite direction. Oh, I heard that. Now, then you can switch. So, you guys will all be with some masters at this later, I promise you. So, you guys good? Oh, I see a lot of people still doing it. No, you're not. Keep on trying. Now, everybody have a seat. So, the reason I am doing this is, one, to wake you guys all up. Okay, so one reason I did this was to try to wake you guys up, because it's always fun to wake up. And hopefully this will come up soon, maybe. There we go. But what I've learned over my many hours of practicing each of these activities is that over time, you create a bit of a muscle memory. So the more that you do it, the less you have to think of it. Just like driving a car, just like walking and chewing gum and any of those activities. And I thought it was kind of a cool analogy of what we are doing for this grant, what we are doing for NGSS and incorporating engineering. Because the first 3 days of this grant, you guys had to reset the framework in your mind of what engineering is. You had to reset in your mind how to incorporate mental activities that really demonstrate science in multiple aspects of students' lives. That's not easy. But as you guys were doing this, and as you guys were struggling through this, some common things that I heard amongst some of the leads is, this is really hard. And this is good that we're doing it here together, because a lot of us may not have been able to figure this out on our own. And I know for a fact, whenever I plan new ideas, I always did it with colleagues because we came up with better ideas together. So I'm hoping that your muscle and mental memory strength for doing these frameworks, for doing this engineering, is easier for you. Because as I said yesterday, if everything stops and dies with this group alone, then we fail. There are people in your departments that are going to be sitting down with NGSS, and they will look at a computer and look at a computer, try to do some planning, and eventually a lot of them will do what we naturally do, which is go back to what you were doing before. And I'm going to challenge each of you guys today to really think of how you could bring other people in. It's kind of, I was trying to find a cool video. You know that one dance thing that they always do at weddings where you first have just the husband and wife dancing and then the music stops, they have to run out, get somebody from the crowd and bring them in, and they start dancing, and then those four people go out and now you have an exponential growth of people on the dance floor. And really, we have 73 people Oh, 78 people as grant participants in this district. 78, that's huge, that's a ginormous number. We have over, what, 300 plus science teachers? If we just do an exponential growth of that, we could do that in like two rounds. But it's really gonna take us working together because we are stronger together. So what we're gonna do is, we're gonna go over what's happening over the course of this year. Because I want you guys to have a firm understanding of what is going to come next and what you guys are committing to. And along the way, as we have those Zoom meetings, we're going to try to infuse some of the ideas and practices and mindsets that you guys have into those so that we can start spreading the wealth of knowledge. Make sense? So here's what I'm going to have you do first. This paper, some of you guys have it all nice and colored, a lot of you guys have black and white. It's called the Intensive Professional Development and Follow-Up Hours. You guys see this one? It's, if you could click Melanie one time. If you need more, there's some around the room. So I just want to make sure that you guys know what's coming up. And if you guys have a calendar, please put these in your calendars early, okay? So I'm just gonna give you a brief overview. First off, Summer Institute PDRs, after today, we are done with the first 30 hours, woo! That was really sad. Try that, after today, we're done! Woo! Yay! So that is gonna be very exciting. So that's 30 hours that you guys have done. The next round is actually going to come in a few chunks, which is why we're going to have you put it in your calendars. Now, we have the ESP meetings in September 29th to 30th, January 5th and 6th, and also May 6th. It's on paper. It's on the paper. So I want to just quickly let you guys know what's generally going to happen on those days. On those days, it's going to be like the first three intensities where there are going to be some demonstration of some practices. This round is most probably going to be from Southwestern College, which is a great partner. They're going to do some examples from their backgrounds. We're also going to have the opportunity to utilize the things that you guys purchased for your curriculum. We're going to have some demos and PDs so that you guys can get your hands wet, dirty, and just learn how to use it. Make sense? And we're also gonna see some new ideas from technology, and we're gonna be able to still plan, but that's what those days are for. Now, I gave some of the curriculum leads some purchasing forms. Now, those purchasing forms, as you guys are planning today, I really want you to think in your mind, what do we need to purchase to really bring the curriculum, really bring the experiences up a notch. and then I need you guys to jot those down, and in an ideal world, get it to me by the end of the day, but if not today, as soon as possible, because the things that we are gonna purchase, the goal is to either use it on the September 29th, 30th, or if it's a second semester item, maybe doing it January 5th or 6th. So that's kind of the idea. Yes?
Do you want us to email it to you?
I'm going to send an email to the leads with that thing, but you can start rough drafting it on paper. Got it? Now, does anybody have, and May 6th is going to be our final date. Yes, it is on a Saturday. We'll make it fun and worth your while, we promise. Okay? Good? And then, next one? Any other additions for this one?
Yeah. Now, you guys also don't act surprised, because when you guys asked me and you signed up for this grant, I gave you these dates, like, when? Anybody? A long time ago, yes. Like December of last year. So don't all go, ooh, what is this? Don't be all surprised. There's only two people in this room that can have that surprise look. Okay? Ken and Ed can have a surprise look because they're new. And nobody else can be surprised. Okay? So look surprised. So those have been what I told you, and we promise not to pull you guys out of your classrooms and get subs. That's just really difficult. So September 29 and 30 is the last 2 days of our fall break. January 5th and 6th is the last 2 days of our winter break. And then May 6th is a Saturday. So it's just one Saturday. Okay? So it's not like we're taking up your Saturdays. So, and that's going to be a fun day because that will be our last day. Okay, I'm going to say it. This is a segue. Some of you know this, and I was going to say it yesterday, but I was just having a good day yesterday and I forgot. There's good news and there's bad news. I don't want a microphone for the bad news. Some of you already know this. So you guys are familiar with No Child Left Behind, correct?
No.
Well, I know. What? Well, No Child Left Behind had its good and bad parts, and we're probably really happy to see it go. Unfortunately, this grant got left behind. Because we are part, one of the good things about No Child Left Behind were the Math and Science Partnership grants. And they have these grants around the nation. I think I told you guys my friend in Minnesota has a Math and Science Partnership grant also that she's doing. But instead of continuing to fund us for the 3 years that we wrote the grant for, it's only going to be funded this year. And so we found out about this recently. You know, we heard rumors they were going to give us some more money and things like that. Current grants that we have going on, for example, the one with the elementary school district, they were decreased by 20%. So those grants out there that are still continuing were decreased. So I'm just like, why didn't you guys like keep funding them and then you could change over to Every Student Succeeds, the new project, but no. But that does not mean let's all be sad, because we have started something here. And you guys know there are people in this room who are great grant writers who can find money under a rock if possible. And I've already spoken with Dr. Del Rosario, and there's a possibility we could fund some summer days next summer, just like we had this summer. And Tony here is an expert in finding grants, and so is Bill. So don't give up. Don't be sad, like thinking, oh, this is the end of this. It's not. Like Tony mentioned, we've started something. We've started a giant movement. There's a third. You know, I know some people are at BITSA today, some people are at the Wild Animal Park, some people are at different institutes.
Well, we're having more fun here.
Exactly. Some people are at Chula Vista doing something, but I know they all wish they were here. So when everybody's all here, there's a third of our science teacher population is in this grant. So we have the ability, like Tony mentioned, to do something great and keep moving our group forward, and we're all taking leadership. We're leaders if we're here in this room learning. So we're not giving up. But what that means is, I've had a couple people go, oh, you know, my foot hurts, I can't come anymore. And I'm like, that's no excuse. We have 1 year to really focus and do the best we can on this grant. But then it doesn't mean it's just gonna be 1 year. We can continue on, okay? Yesterday, I'm sorry, I wasn't visiting with all of you yesterday. I was schmoozing with that other lady. And I'm like, You know, there may be some people coming by. We're going to smile and schmooze them because we want to keep going. We want to keep getting funded. So if you guys know anyone that has tons of money, you know, just, hey, come on. So we're going to try to keep going, keep getting funded. I know you guys know people, so we're gonna keep working on this, okay? So let's smile, it's not over. We're gonna keep going, but sadly, our grant will be, our last day will basically be May 6th, that's why Tommy said it's gonna be fun. But we'll probably still have some PLC dates after that and some observation dates after that, but that will be our final fun day, but not final. I don't wanna say the word final because it's gonna be our last day of this cycle. There's more to come, okay? All right, so don't let that be, are y'all bummed?
Don't be bummed.
Don't be bummed.
This is why I'm here. My job is to make this make sure that we continue going.
Yes.
And so I'm really good at finding money.
Yeah, he is. So yes. So don't be bummed. But that was just kind of a natural progression into that. So I don't want to bum you out. So now, so Tony's going to continue talking about our professional learning committee, our PLCs. Now, some of the language may be a little different than you might use, but remember, we're using a lot of grant language. The language that's in the grant, so that's some of the language we're going to be using. We may call it something different at our school, but we're going to use that language. So Tony's going to explain kind of the rest of the year what we're going to be doing, and then you guys will have a better view of what's to come.
So the next part is this, the PLCs. Part of the PLCs is when you guys will get together specifically in your grade levels or the subcategories, so 7th, 8th, high school biology, high school chemistry, high school physics. Those are the dates that we have set up where you guys would just be pulled out and ideally meeting in your smaller groups so that you guys could continue with the lesson sharing, the lesson planning. And we'll go from that, similar to what you guys are doing now, but a little bit more intensive with more support. Got it? Then there's the classroom observation / coaching sessions. This cycle is going to be from two different cycles. The first cycle is October 1st to January 31st. Exact dates and times to be determined. This is something that I want to stress. When we observe, it's not to be evaluative. It's to see what's going on in the classrooms. Has the mind shift occurred where we're incorporating these practices? What can we do better to support? What can we learn from you to be like, wow, that's a really cool idea to maybe talk about in the PLCs, sharing ideas, sharing practices. Not evaluative, this is something that we're using to help grow together. Does that make sense? And then the next one is the second cycle is gonna be February 1st, May 30th. Now, people have asked, do we have to be doing the lessons that we are creating right now? The answer is, that'd be really cool if we can, but realistically, not everybody's gonna be able to do that. So, what we're looking for is that mind shift, that practice shift, where you're just incorporating some of these ideas and practices. We don't have to see an exact lesson that you guys have planned from this. So hopefully that's gonna lower your anxiety about that. Any questions? Yes. Yeah, we have money for the subs, yes.
But they're over fall break.
Those shouldn't be over fall break, are they?
9:22?
Fall break, yes, there is one.
Yeah,
in physics.
Yeah, the physics, the 9:22 is over fall
9:22? Then we will have to look at adjusting that, so.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for catching. 9:22.
We'll
fix it. Physics 9:22. So we'll adjust it. Thank you so much for catching that one. If there's any other issues that you see, let Melanie, myself, or Bobby know, and we'll make those adjustments. You guys good? All right,
I'm gonna, since I bummed everybody out, I'm gonna do this real fast to get everybody going. Okay, it's all about the middle school today. Yes, that's why I'm so crazy. I was a middle school teacher for many years. I love it, especially eighth grade. Now, I'm not being prejudiced today, but it has come to my attention today for our Golden Light Bulb Awards that some eighth grade teachers were doing some great stuff yesterday. Now, I didn't get to see it because I was, you know, schmoozing that lady from, you know, the project. I didn't get to see it, but I heard from other people. I have spies everywhere that tell me what's going on. So the first person I would like to recognize, now I just happen to know this person. I happen to share a classroom with this person. This person and I have been through a lot together. and I know what a great teacher this person is, but it was brought to my attention that this person was doing a lot of great stuff yesterday, was working on the instructional guide, was putting everything in order, was just being very collegial, has been a real champion for this grant. So I would like to give our first Golden Light Bulb of the award today to Mr. Dan Frank. Council Herman. All right. Okay, it's still all about eighth grade. Sorry. Yesterday it was about high school. Today it's eighth grade. Okay, now this person, I didn't know this person very well, but I feel like I know this person much better now, and I'm so happy for knowing this person. This person also did us a huge favor. Now, we didn't snap our fingers and mysteriously this all appeared. We've had to have some planning sessions. Some of your lead teachers, the professors, we've had planning sessions. And I sort of like called this person and said, oh, hey, can we sort of like use your school? And by the way, can we sort of use your classroom? We invaded this person's space. So this person has really been key in helping us get everything organized. And she has really bonded with our university professors. And really, when everybody hears what eighth grade is doing, it's like, wow, you're doing this. We're gonna like solve the asteroid problem for the whole entire universe, I think. And so I want to give this award to Ms. Maria Canales. So these will be the last from today, but just wait. We're gonna be watching today. And in September, you never know what's gonna happen. We come back in September. All right, great job, you guys. Everybody deserves one. I just don't have enough of those. I bought every one in the store, and I may have to go buy more of those. Okay, what we're gonna do now, let's get one more.
You want me to click on it?
Yeah. Okay, so as you guys have heard and have seen, there's a new framework out. Really? Yeah, there is. All right. The new one just came out on the 29th of June, which was a few weeks ago. And 30,000 people made comments. I know Pete, Adrian, Joan, Susan, we went to an elementary school and actually went to a session and were able to input with some people from the State Department. Now, some of you, how many of you have actually had a chance to look at this? Oh, really? In the summer? How many of you really not had a chance to look at this? All right. It's okay. It's okay. I haven't really looked at it either. I haven't had a chance. But what we're doing is going to be driven by the new draft framework. And so we want to take a look at the different chapters, the different progressions. And this is something, I'm not gonna sit down with you guys and go, let's look at chapter 3. No, we don't have time to do that. So this is something that you need to take a look at. Something we might do, we did a scavenger hunt over the old draft at one of our zone meetings. We may take a little bit deeper look at some of the chapters later on, but we wanna make sure that you guys have, this is what you're gonna be teaching. So it's kind of behooves everyone to take a look at this. And so, again, grades 6 through 8 are considered middle school, and you guys know that, right? We don't have a sixth grade, but it's okay, because we were gonna get it handled. We've got preferred integrated model, which is what we're doing in our middle school. 9 through 12, we have different models, and you guys are familiar, we've talked about, we have 2 years required. So right now, our model is really, would be the 4-course model. Even though we don't have 4 courses that are required, we have pure chemistry, pure physics, pure biology, there's no integration at all. Now, there's the 3-course model, biology, chemistry, physics, with the earth science infused. There's the integrated model, we have integrated science at every grade level. So these are the different models that we're gonna be working on this year to figure out what is best for Sweetwater, what is best for our students. So that is one of our next big goals that we're going to be looking at in the Sweetwater District. But of course, this has to go through community, this has to go through our school board. So this is something that we want to make sure we have enough knowledge about this information so we can present it and present it well, and we can all make a best informed decision. So that is what that is. So if you're confused a little bit about that, Tony and I can help you a little bit more navigating that if you haven't seen this before. But again, I'm not going to take the time right now to go into it deeper, but I'm more than happy to come around and show you a little bit more about it. I actually made copies of the old draft, and when I mean old draft, I'm talking about the one that came out in January. The old one came out in January and closed in the end of February. And then people got really busy recreating 30,000 comments, so we had, and some of them were my comments. Pete, how many comments did you have? 50? I think I had about 5 major comments, because I did one of the, I went through one of the chapters. I didn't do actually the grade level. So I know some of my comments were in there. Did they listen? Hopefully they did. But there were 30,000 teachers that gave comments. So as we look again, assessment of student learning, so some of these chapters, can we scroll? So these are, so not only do we have content, we have biology, chemistry, physics, earth science content, we have some other things. And what California has decided to change in our national NGSS framework, they put in access and equity, because in California we're very well aware of access and equity of our students, and our assessment may look a little different, instructional strategies, how to teach the NGSS, the pedagogical implications, implementing high quality science instruction, professional learning, leadership, and supports. That's something that we definitely want to look at to help you guys with your professional learning and support as we are still transitioning. Chapter 11, instructional resources. There's a lot of resources. Some of them we've given to you already, but check that out. There's a lot of resources to help you with your lesson planning today, to help you with lesson planning in your classroom. And the appendices. And the glossary. Computer science, that's new. That wasn't there before. Yay, Bill, yay, computer science. And Shannon, all those of you that teach computer science. So, yay. And then high school, 3-year model, every science every year, interesting. Some of these are new that when we were at the last revision we didn't see. So somebody decided to put some new things on there. So this is very interesting, guys. This is our future, this is our students' future. Definitely take a look at this, and we'll be, again, working a little bit more with this. I know that some of the middle schools have taken the new integration and have really run with it. And like I was saying, we have put together a Snickers bar. We have put together, oh, let's teach this and let's teach this. And we've mixed things together, but true integration is when you're teaching a unit and you can teach everything. It looks more like a Three Musketeers. It's smoothly seamless. Like peanut, I don't like peanut butter, but like smooth peanut butter, okay? It's seamless, where you've got earth science taught with biology, taught with physics. It's very seamless, integrated. And I think a very good example of that would be what 7th grade is doing. So if you guys wanna pop over to 7th grade and see what they're doing today, that would be a great example of a seamless, integrated idea. Okay.
Yes.
Question, just like on timeline, how long do you think it's going to take before, as a district, we decide whether we're going to go with the 3-course model or the 4-course model?
Okay, let me back up.
So like,
okay, so the framework itself, we're gonna be looking at this. It's going to close sometime at the end of August. So if you guys want to make comments, I have that, and I'll show you where you can make comments, or we may have a district meet where we sit down together and talk about it and make comments for the state. It's going to close. They're going to have to put it in front of the board. It's going to be November. And then it's like, ta-da, it's done. Well, after that, all the publishers are going to go bananas and start grabbing a hold of this and creating textbooks and creating materials. But we don't want to jump the gun. We don't want to buy some cruddy textbooks that we don't really need. We're going to take the time to look and figure out what is best for our school. And we're probably not going to have an adoption until 2019. There could be some opportunities for pilot testing in the spring. So all this is happening. You know, we've been talking about this for the last couple of years, and it's starting to move toward. So to answer your question about when we're going to adopt, I don't know the exact date. I know that it's probably going to, I would assume that it would happen sometime between now and January. Probably by next semester we'll know. And that would be an answer probably for Dr. Del Rosario, who's the head of curriculum, who's not here today. but I'm assuming that it will be sometime this semester that those decisions will be made, because we need to decide so that we can start planning for the following year to be whatever we're going to do. Okay. So this year is kind of like status quo, what we're doing now, but looking to the future and planning. And if we do need to learn more physics, then we will learn more physics. If we need to learn more biology, we'll figure that out. We'll bring in Dr. Shapiro to the rescue. If we need to learn more earth science, Ken to the rescue. So we will figure this out together as a team. So sadly, I can't answer that, but you know, the next time we get together, I bet I will have an answer for that in September. All right, bundling really fast. I know, I feel like I'm on a...
Really fast?
Yes.
Melissa and I just looked, and the 7th and 8th grade integrated has not changed from the last grade.
Yay, has not changed. I have a question though, because I've been sort of busy. Hello. Thank you, Tony, for not making me busy anymore. But I'm still busy. You know me, I'll never not be busy. But how different from what we bundled in the beginning, how different is what the state has done? Pretty different.
So we always had since NGSS, we've had an integrated model in middle school, but we taught it as a unit of physics, a unit of chemistry, a unit of biology, and now it's all jumbled up. So like the first unit we teach has two physics standards, a biology standard, and an earth science standard. So.
Creamy peanut butter.
Yeah,
exactly.
Creamy peanut butter.
All together. Exactly. So what we did, I think that Sweetwater should have patented this, but what we did, and I know this started with Mr. Spiegel from the county office, I know this started with Hilltop Middle and Castle Park Middle, National City Middle. We and Gina was there when we started bundling and we had all the performance expectations. We're like, okay, so we've got ecology, we've got this, we've got, wow, how does this all fit together? So we just got together and put everything together in the order that we thought it would flow best. That's bundling, and guess what? We were like, oh, let's put it together and bundle it. Now, bundling is a new keyword. Phenomenon is one of the new keywords now. Bundling is the new keyword, okay? So look right there, bundling the NGSS. So it talks about bundling. There's a webinar about bundling. We've already bundled. But as Shannon mentioned, we're gonna need to really figure out how we can put physics together with biology, with earth science. In high school, how can we make the engineering flow in with the human impacts? How can we really seamlessly transition? Unless we go integrated high school, you know, I'm not ruling out anything at all at this point. Okay, so these are some bundling examples that you guys may want to take a look at. And it says read first the instruction and guide. So this is kind of the latest thing right now. So I just wanted to show you guys some information in Canvas. I'm going to show you Canvas in just a minute. All of this is here if you want in your spare time to take a look at the bundling. And we'll be talking about it a little bit more. But again, this just came out. Actually, Catherine from the science project told me about this yesterday. You guys need to take a look at the bundling. She goes, I know you've already bundled some things, and your teachers are familiar with how the order goes, but again, you may want to reshift once the framework comes out. Reshift everything and realign, and that again is what 7th grade has been already starting on. So it's good to have someone as a starting point. Thank you, 7th grade.
We're gonna go to Canvas, or are you ready?
Let's see, we'll do Canvas. Okay, one of the questions that y'all had on the last review was Canvas. I know Canvas is sort of like broccoli. You like it or you don't.
It's not broccoli.
Eggplant?
It's like a Snickers bar.
Like Brussels sprouts.
Brussels sprouts.
I love Brussels sprouts.
Okay.
It's amazing.
I know. Canvas can be amazing. It can. The more I use Canvas, I do like it. I know learning management systems are the thing. I know some of you have used Edmodo. Facebook is a learning management system. Some of you have used Haiku at the county office. Some of you have been at USD or UCSD and used Blackboard. So some of you, believe it or not, you know more about our learning systems than not. But this is what Sweetwater is using, and yes, I like it a lot more now, Shannon. I usually just email Shannon and go, Shannon, would you upload stuff? Because I go, oh, I think it goes here. Let me get a dent. It takes me like forever. And Shannon's like, well, just upload it. And Anna does the same thing to me. By the time I go, oh, let's make it pretty and let's make it purple, they have it uploaded. So I'm learning how to get faster and not make it quite so fancy. So this is our page. Is there anyone that's not into this page that will admit it? Okay. So I have sent the link to this I don't know how many times, but that's okay. If you need the link, I will give the link to you again. But it is here because this is where we're going to house our information. And this is where we're going to communicate if we need to. We also have Drive, so we are very, very advanced here technologically. A lot of districts don't have a learning management system, so we're very, you know, communication is key. This is a great way to communicate. Okay, and there's our Drive. So, and the Drive is the link there. Tony clicked up at the top where it says the link to Drive. And I made a physics folder for Lindsay yesterday. So I added a physics folder. So if there's something that some of us have the master ability to add and things and some don't, but I just want to make sure everybody has access today before you leave, because some of you were having trouble and didn't have the access, but we'll make sure that happens. So these are all of our folders, lesson samples, science practices, engineering, and crazy paperwork. Y'all aren't supposed to see that one. The 5E lesson planning, biology. Yeah, don't look in some of my secret folders there. Okay.
Do we have GS1 and GS2 here? Or do we have to create those folders?
GS1 and GS2? Is it up there? Okay, there will be a GS1 and GS2 today.
But okay. This is where you'll be sharing all your folders in this Google Drive, because this is where everybody has access to it. So watch your videos.
Is there anything in biology?
Yeah.
Okay, so click on biology, we'll see what's in there.
Some of them have it put theirs in the Drive, but ours is the GIS one.
Okay.
So I think there's two.
So this is the GIS one is the activity that Gina's group is working on right now.
Can I make a recommendation?
Yes.
Yes.
Just because I know some of my colleagues are a little more organized than I am, can we put subfolders in there labeled by the PE?
Yes.
And then put all the stuff in each PE? If we could all do that the same, that would be awesome.
Some of the PEs are overlap. Well, maybe, I don't know.
Or how about, why don't we just kind of do this? Why don't we, like, each group kind of does the way they feel is best, and then maybe we'll come back together and look and see if we can come up with a uniform way. We may not be able to, but our middle school has something uniform and high school has something. So right now you can just kind of, so this is something that Gina and I know Dave have been working on. This is their 5A lesson plan. So it's right there where we can all see it. We all have access to it. Okay, so did you guys see this link right here? Google Drive. That's how Tony got to Google Drive. So you can go to Google Drive on your own, or you can go to the link from Canvas right there. So we'll scroll down a little bit more. Oh, Twitter, tweet. There's ESP, CMSP. There's our hashtag, and there's Sweetwater underscore group killing. Don't tweet right now. Wait till I sit down. But you can tweet some stuff. I know. Thank you, Ryan. Awesome. Ryan tweeted yesterday. Thank you. So, yeah, you guys can tweet because we really want. I had a lot of people go, ooh, that's cool. There was the Department of Education was like. I'm like, awesome. Money, you know. We're always thinking about money and fame, and we want to keep going. So we're going to go back one more time to Canvas, and I'm going to show you guys where the famed videos are going to be. So let's go ahead and scroll down, and we're going to go to the modules. And I want to give props to Shannon again for helping me. She put all this in like 5 minutes, and I'm like, oh, click, takes me a long time. So obviously, this is some stuff that we did on day one. So if you'll see how this is, we'll scroll back up a little bit, where it says day one. Okay, so that was day one. That was June 6th. So everything is labeled by the day. All the activities that we did, Bobby's awesome brain PowerPoint is there. Odesma's rainforest activity is there. A lot of things are there that we did. A little bit of history about the grant. Now see, it says video will be here with a summary. So Hugo's videos will be here. So if you were absent on that day, Tony's going to give you more information, and that's where you will click to see that video. And we're getting those uploaded. Now, the reason they're not uploaded now is because the guy that uploads them, he moved. The other guy that could also upload them, he was on vacation.
And now we figure out how to do it. So we'll be up. We're submitting the videos hopefully by tomorrow. We'll be up by next week.
Yeah.
So it's coming. It won't be blocked by our district. So we're good.
Yeah, because a lot of stuff is blocked, and you know how videos and your social media, so you have to be very good. We thought, oh yeah, we'll just upload these. No, not so easy. So we'll keep scrolling down a little bit more. So you can see day three, that was yesterday. And then you can see the our NGSS lesson plan template. You can see where there's the video right there. Or if you want to go back and see what we did, just have a review. Now here's today, day five. Okay, there's our agenda. The one pager that you have here is right there, okay? And Tony and I are gonna discuss the framework draft, the link to how to get there, what I just showed you. The framework draft is there. Some information about conferences are here. Okay, bundling is here. So all the stuff that we're gonna talk about today, we're gonna put into Canvas. If you have something, Rachel had that wonderful article yesterday. We uploaded that to day four. So anything you guys have and you wanna upload it, if you can upload it, you can give it to Tony and he can upload it for you. But this is some information. So I wanna talk about real quick and I'll turn it over to Tony. Conferences, there's a lot of stuff going on and so I'm gonna show this to you very quickly. So right here, we're gonna click on the California Teacher Summit. Did anybody go to this last year? This was awesome. I know you have to get a sub and all that stuff, it's hard, but this is a really cool opportunity. I got to be a part of an ed camp, an NGSS ed camp. I didn't know I was doing that, but it ended up being an ed camp. It was great. I met some teachers from all over the state. So this is gonna be, you get together and you talk about educational issues of today, and you get to hear some motivational speakers. And this is the flyer, and it's free, and it's at the Town and Country Hotel, and it's gonna be next week, July 29th. Okay, so we'll go back, and that's just some information. It's a great opportunity coming up. And we'll click on this one, Tony, the California Science Education Conference. Now, California Science Teachers Association, there's several different associations, but the California one is in Palm Springs this year. Awesome. How many have been? Super fun. It's a lot of fun, okay? And if you're take a look at this because you're gonna need to, you know, talk to your principal, look at funds, figure out how, you know, how we're going to go. I don't know if the district's gonna have funds to pay for you to go. This is something that you may need to ask your school. Very rarely, I know recently, have principals turn people down. It's getting better where you ask them and you ask them now if you can go. But then you don't wanna ask them when other people ask them, you wanna be first. So then they can say no to all the other people. So this is gonna be, and this is the registration, it's October 21 through 23rd in Palm Springs. A lot of great, great information. And then the last one, this is like the mother of all conferences. This is the first time it's been on the West Coast in like 16 years. NSCA is here. Yay! It was in Nashville last year. Yes, I went line dancing with Alicia last year. She's not even listening. Alicia, I'm just kidding. I said Alicia and I went line dancing in Nashville. So we went to Nashville, we learned a lot. Got a lot of great information, some stuff that we're gonna share in some of the Zone meetings. But here it is, sun, surf, and science, what more do you want? Right there. And even better, I know this is bad, it's good but bad, it's during spring break, so you don't need a sub. March 30, April 2. So if you haven't ever been to a national science conference, here's your chance, people, you can drive. No plane flight, no sub, there you go. Sun, surf, science, no sub. Sub, surf, sand, science, mileage. Okay? Awesome. Everything you need to know about it is right there. And I would suggest, you know, thinking about it. Thinking about it, because it's a great opportunity for you. And Tony's got some other very interesting opportunities for you. He's going to tell us about it.
I know we're going slightly long, so I'm going to try to do this in 5 minutes or less, because there's a few things that are kind of cool that are coming down the pipeline. Now, I love this one. UCSD emailed Dr. Joe Rosario, and they pretty much said, we have $500 per teacher, up to three teachers for 3 years, to do interpretive dance. For chemistry. Totally serious. Totally serious. So if you're interested in doing interpretive dance, well, here's the deal. It has to be with all of your students, and they would do something in the gym. And the teacher who coordinates with the person through at UCSD can get $500. And they're looking for up to three teachers. So if you're interested in doing that and coordinating your students to do that with you or groups of students, give me your name. Raise up your hand so I know who you are, if you're thinking about it. But seriously, we need to know this because the grant is due by July 20th. They want to work with SUH. They want to work with Sweetwater. But if nobody's interested, it's going to go to the next district. And this is the greatest group. So chemistry ideas, $500, work with students, and it will be so much fun, and I cannot wait to see it. So is anybody interested?
I have a student who...
If you have a student, use them to get $500. Okay. But so if you're interested, one, two, okay, great. I think it could be any. Like, I'll submit your names, and then that person will contact you and work it out with you. Does that make sense? So, if you're interested, just see me. I'll put your name in. I'll email directly to Dr. Joe Rosario. All right. So that's number one. Number two has Ed Camps. Now, has anybody heard of Ed Camps? I actually have never heard of an Ed Camp before, but they're actually really big. Has anybody ever seen the movie Accepted? It's a great movie where a person made up his own college and decided to make courses based on what they were interested in, and he got like a big whiteboard and wrote out all the different classes that they're gonna take. And you would think that that's just bizarre and weird, but it's actually a big thing right now. And it's actually a really big thing in education. And this Ed Camp is actually going to be coordinated by Sweetwater, and it's a time where teachers from all over the county, right now I think they have 30 or 40 signed up, half of which are from different districts, and they would just come together without any specific agenda, and people would talk about what they want to focus on, and you would break up into different think tanks and just do whatever you guys want. I've never done this. I'm actually interested in how that would turn out, because it's a different experience where you just get people who are motivated to work on something, whoever knows what. If you have a specific agenda, I'm sure you can push that agenda, but it'd be an interesting idea. So this is going to be through our district, through professional growth. I'm going to make a link on the Canvas page for this one. So if you're interested in that, that's a good one. Now, other things really, really, really quickly. There was Canvas, which you've done, conferences. Now there's a round table. I'm going to suggest, because of time, that we're going to do the roundtable later. I know, Bill, were you interested in talking about some of the technology stuff right now, or do you want to table until later? I'll leave that decision up to you.
What do you guys feel like right now?
Get to work, or?
I'll talk.
Well, how about this? When we're done, right at the end, we're going to kind of give you an idea of what's to come up with technology. Ms. Bax. It's up to you now. Okay, so we have one more thing and we're going to spread it into groups.
We're probably just going to use our teacher voices as well. Does that sound like I need a mic? Okay.
What?
Okay, so I asked if we could put this slide up. Many of you have probably seen this slide before. It's one of my favorites because it really puts things into perspective for us. I think a lot of people, including even special educators sometimes, we think that, you know, oh, that's not fair if I do something for one student because all the other students are gonna want me to do that for them. And honestly, the truth is the equality for all of our students is not equity. And equity is the thing that we really wanna shoot for. We want our kids to feel like they have equity, they have involvement, they have the same rights, they have the same, you know, chance to do what other students are doing. So this just really puts it into perspective. So you've got on the first side, you've got your equality, which means let's give them all the same type of scaffolding, which how many people are helped out of that? One kind of gets the best of both worlds. The other one's kind of, he gets a little bit. And then you got a kid completely left out. So if you do the same thing for all of your students, thinking that that's equity, it's really equality. And equality is not really what we want for our students. We want equity for our students. So you see that the kid that obviously can see over the fence may not need any kind of scaffolding or differentiation or special help or anything like that. The kid in the middle, he might need, just a little extra. Maybe a buddy to kind of help him. Maybe feed him some vocabulary words ahead of time. Talk with him, pull him aside, make sure everything's going okay. Kind of put him on a monitor basis. And then you've got your kid that really needs some help. And that might be a kid that's mainstreamed in your science class that you really want to work with your science special ed teacher to say, help me with this guy. He's really struggling. I really liked what Tony did this morning when he was doing some of those things, because I was trying to do this one and feeling like, oh my God, I don't have an entry point for this at all. I cannot do this. I am struggling. And I want you to kind of remember how some of those exercises make you feel. And you're uncomfortable because you can't do it. And you're thinking, wow, I'm usually pretty good at most things, but I can't do this thing and I'm struggling. Now, it's kind of fun because we're doing that in a room full of all of us, and you see many of us struggling to do that. So it's a pretty safe environment. But think about being a student in a room where 99.9% of the kids are getting it, and you're the only one sitting there like, well, I don't know what's going on. It's embarrassing. It's scary. You don't want to raise your hand and say that you don't get it. So it's kind of our job to help think about that for those students before they even get to that point where they're going to be embarrassed and they're going to feel lost. Because we've all felt that, and most of us have, special devices that we use so that we don't look silly, and we know that and those kids have the same sort of thing. I'm not going to ask the question because I don't want to look like the only one that doesn't get it. So we, as teachers, have to kind of figure out, what do I need to do so that all of my kids are involved? And so this next slide, too, that I just want to talk about a little bit. How many of you have heard of Universal Design for Learning? It's a big buzzword. It's out there. We'll be talking about it even more. I definitely want to do some more PD on Universal Design for Learning. But Universal Design for Learning comes from the idea of architecture. So really, it came from the idea that when I'm building something, a structure, if I don't think about all the possibilities for what could be happening in that structure, I have to go back later and then engineer something to make it work. So, for example, say that I create a building and I'm not thinking about the fact that I might have some people in a wheelchair have to come to this building. Well, now I have to add a ramp. And maybe I don't have the perfect place for it. I kind of add it. It's just like, I'm half, what Melanie said the other day, I'm half assing it a little bit, just adding it on, right? Because you haven't thought about it before. It's not aesthetically pleasing. Maybe you didn't think, oh, Braille. I've got people who might be riding in my elevator and coming in here who can't see. Maybe I should put some Braille on the elevator. Maybe I should, things like that. If we think about all of the people on the fringes, all of the people who could potentially come to our building, and just kind of, make that in our classroom setting, all of the students that could potentially come to our lesson, if we think about everybody involved when we create that lesson, then we don't have that kind of half-booting it at the end where we're going, oh, yeah, I forgot, I got a kid here with a learning disability. Oh yeah, I forgot, I've got a kid who's hard of hearing. All of these different things. And now you're throwing stuff onto the lesson. That's not your best work. Your best work comes from when you're sitting there and you're creating that lesson and you're thinking about all of the things that can happen and all of the things that could go wrong and all the things that could go right. I'm including thinking about your gate kids. How can I make sure to keep them involved? Your English language learners. How can I keep them involved and keep talking about language for them and keep them engaged and wanting to be part of the process. So the idea of Universal Design for Learning, it asks you to do all of your lessons with that in mind. And the beauty of where we're starting right now with NGSS and with this grant is that we all are kind of starting fresh, looking at our older lessons and creating newer lessons and saying, how can we NGSSify these things and make them more engaging and make them more inquiry-based and make them with phenomenon. Let's just add this extra piece to say, let's think about everyone that could potentially come to my space to hear what's going on. the lesson that Gina did. If you see, she created it perfectly where she said, this lesson is designed with special education students and English language learners in mind. I go to all the zones and I'll hear teachers say to me, they'll call me over, hey Christine, look, I did this PT and I made sure to add this little extra thing because I think that this is really gonna help our SPED students. And I figured if it'll help our SPED students, it'll help all of them, so I'm just gonna put it in the thing. And I'm like, oh my God, warm fuzzies. I tell all of my other subject area friends about how great science is because you guys have embraced it. Matt just came to me today and was telling me how he was scaffolding something that he was doing. I mean, you guys are constantly thinking about it. And as I've said before, and I'll say it again, science is the great equalizer. That is that place where if I put my SPED kid into your room, their eyes are wide open because they want to know. You've got to hook naturally because science is so dang interesting. So if you can get them hooked in, there's an entry point for every single one of them. We just have to figure out how do we scaffold for those who need it the most? How do we figure out how to keep those ones who don't need the scaffold and engaged and involved and part of this process? Because science, it's invariably ingrained in you that you want to be part of it. So even as a SPED student, even as an English language student, I feel like I am compelled to try to learn that vocabulary, to try to learn that language so I can be a part of this cool group that's doing this cool stuff. You naturally have that interest that's involved. So take that and think about that. And when you're writing your lessons, all I ask is that you keep that in the back of your mind. You're thinking about who could potentially come to my room. Think about that in your PLCs. Who could come to my room? The English language learner. The kid who's deaf and hard of hearing. The kid who is maybe blind or has trouble with seeing things. The kid with a learning disability. The kid with ADHD. What do I do to engage and keep all of those students interested? And I know Anna wanted to add just a little piece too, to talk about how to keep...
She just took...
I know, I'm sorry. I do that. I told you, kick me.
But just to reiterate the same exact things, just keep those English learners in mind. And then remember that the things that we're doing right in your class, they're actually learning a language through your content. So they're working double duty to get to be able to understand your material plus learning a second language. So just keep those students in mind, and then just three words to remember for our English learners is, do they collaborate together to use the language? Are they talking about the content in your class? So are they collaborating in order for them to use the language? Are they interpreting the input that you give them, whether it's text, any type of text, or if it's just listening? Do they get the opportunity to interpret the meaning the way you need them to interpret the meaning of the text that you're giving them? And then are they producing language, whether it's verbal or written? So three important key words for all of our English learners this year is collaboration, interpretation of text, and producing language. So that's my two cents. And
perfect.
Thank you.
Yeah. And then just one last thing I want to leave you guys with. Growth mindset is also a new thing that we've been talking about a lot. It'll also be something that will be coming down the pipe. We will be doing more professional development with it. There is one thing that I want to leave you with that for me is the most important piece of growth mindset. If it's the only thing that you take away from any PD that you go to for growth mindset, and I mean for your students and I mean for yourself, because growth mindset is a paradigm shift even for me. I find myself going, oh my God, to remember that vocabulary, to remember to give positive feedback to my students in a way that reminds them that I am giving them feedback about the process, not about them. If I say to Gina, oh, wow, you did this really well, you're so smart. So then what does that mean when I didn't say something to Shannon? Does that mean that Shannon was stupid? Shannon didn't do well, so Shannon's probably stupid. Right? But think about that. Is that a message that we're sending to our kids when we do that? You were really smart at this. Well, then I must be dumb at this. And if I'm dumb at that, I'm not going to try. And we've all felt that way. You all know if someone asks you to do something and you're not good at it, you're going to kind of go, ooh. How many of you volunteered to do karaoke when you're completely sober? Because you know you're so great out there. You go, oh man, I think I need to go to the restroom or get another drink. So we all know that. If it's something that's uncomfortable for us, we don't want to put ourselves out there because we felt that shunning. We felt that embarrassment. We felt that, you know, if I can't do it, I'll never be able to do it. So here is my favorite piece. Just keep this in the back of your mind about yourself and your personal growth and about your students. Growth mindset may say, I can't do that. And students may say that in your room. Remind them and yourselves, you can't do that yet. Just add the word yet to it, because all of us, if we keep our minds
working toward it, we can do these things. Honestly, hard work goes even further than talent. We've seen that. So please, just keep that in the back of your mind. If you say I can't do that, or your students say I can't do that, just add that word, yet. And that's it. That's my probably dollar, not even a few cents. So. Thanks, guys.
And here's where we go off and do great things. So quick reminders, and then you guys will go off. For you guys, one, the goal again is to work on those 5E lessons. Work in your PLC groups. Now, because some of these subject areas have multiple groups, what I would like to encourage you guys to do is really bring it together at some point, because I want you guys to make sure you guys are all on the same page with where you guys are at. So share out lessons in excess while other members give feedback and suggestions if you have multiple groups. Upload your lessons on a Google Drive in some nice shape or fashion. And also, this is kind of professional development for all of us. You guys all have different ideas and you interpret things differently, but we would love and we kind of need you guys to come up with a 10 to 15 minute presentation for the group to really highlight the ideas or the work you've been working on. There is no confinement of how you have to present. It can be the interpretive dance. It can be power. It can be whatever you want. But we're looking at tasters so that other people could, you know, have some other ideas of where they could go from here. Make sense?
Okay, so the only the one thing we're missing here is they don't really know which atoms are positive and which atoms are negative.
That's what I'm saying.
So and that's kind of a law. But we only want them to understand hydrogen and oxygen on this. It's a blowtorch.
Can you teach me that we have
How do you get through that firewall?
I think it's your
Home Depot.
Yeah, what do you have to go to get it?
$16.
Including your
nozzle and everything? No, it used to come up every time.
You might let us order from Home Depot. What's at it? Let's just put it on there. I know there's 30 minutes. It's not like we have bonds.
They're
not
bonds.
That's you. Yeah.
It used to do that, but it doesn't do that. Okay, eBay does.
Either way, I don't know why it's loading some things and not others.
All students should be in a classroom for the first time in a
One that you set up, and then the flex cam would never fit just right. Everything's kind of blurred by the time you like get it.
Which sounds fine to me.
That's a lot.
You know, and it's just kind of
nice. We're not doing that anymore, so you don't need to get into like a
So wait, did they have this on
You just need to. No, I think it's true.
I
don't have it at all. Right. We just need to look at stuff like, you know, comparing sand to different kinds of sand or like different rock.
What are polar molecules? Is a polar
bear? Polar bear.
Is your name?
Oh, you know what? My Project Lead the Way will have it, right? Will it show what I'm registered for?
But I realize.
Oh no, if I go into that website.
This happens every single time.
They'll do anything just to be here. Why?
Well, I didn't write it down, of course.
How did you know, like, right now?
I haven't gotten any confirmation from them, so.
After it, it's like, what? That was
so it's hard to like find anything that doesn't have a
star.
But
I know. So, but here's the problem. Like, we're going to have to change, like,
if we don't do polarity,
we're going to have to change stuff.
Like, yeah,
I'll take out the right. So, and I think the standard
one and go back to
covers polarity.
And then they have the ability to come back.
Like, how do you teach structure without teaching polarity? Crystalline structure. It has a crystalline structure because of the polarity, right?
So what if we just
no one is letting know if that was a sure thing?
We can, yeah, that's fine with me.
Leave while you're on sabbatical.
No. Interesting.
No. Assessment does not include valence electrons or bonding energy, ionic nature of subunits.
Mm-hmm. So it's just the idea that some of them get together and some of them don't. So like maybe after we play with the magnets and stuff, we just tell them that magnets are just like atoms. So when you put like the right ends together, they come together, and sometimes they don't.
Explainer thing is really good.
So that's because of the charges.
There's one here of teach engineering separating chromatography.
Do you have a
so you separate the different colors?
No.
Yeah, I don't see it, but they're
like they use the video of the water balloon.
I want to be.
But that's cohesion. That's like a
whatever people are comfortable.
It's not.
Yeah.
It's cohesive because
just know it as polar. It's really hard to do.
That's why it's thick.
I really is really not that hard. I can do it.
It's not that hard.
Attention viewers, this is the end of session one. You have 5 minutes to get to session two. Again, you have 5 minutes to get to session two.
And I think that, yes. I think in the beginning it will be that way. I think it's all year.
So this lesson will be back.
I mean, just get the options of
water polarity, right?
And that's obligation and extension.
And the first thing you wanted to do was?
So how do I want to do that?
Water.
You have to brown paper towel, a couple drops of water, and then see which one evaporates water faster. Because we're talking about particle motion.
Mm-hmm.
And so, obviously, the one on the brown paper towel, water is going to evaporate faster.
Yes.
And so, then, how do we do this? Because that's, I think, what I'm talking about. Have them play with the magnets and then look at that one line.
Molecules moving faster.
And then how
will we write up
all the
information?
Now, let's go back.
Okay.
Really, what is drawing or reflection?
Go ahead. Okay.
How does
and
this help?
This works it. I mean, I think, remember when we were looking at this the other day, right?
Like
these
are
the teacher notes. These are what you say. Elaborate.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
You want to
you
tie it
all
into
that river.
So I think I'm like, I'm going to ask her this.
I think I had an interesting idea about maybe we can tie it in with using the stream and talking about how we're using different water motion. Maybe we could talk about like the warm one being like the sun hitting the stream.
Uh-huh.
And then we could have evaporation be happening that way.
Uh-huh.
And then maybe we could use the we used to do it just an observation of ice and then no one knows. So maybe we could do something with ice and just talk about how in the winter the river would freeze and then ask them to explain if it's the difference between a chemical change and a physical change. And if they understood particle motion, they should be able to tie this into these are physical changes. It's just the motion.
I think they're doing something with like water freezing.
Okay.
And
so maybe we just do the warm
units right
part
before us.
Maybe we just do the evaporation part.
Okay.
And have
I know we should
figure out what exactly what they're doing, so we, because our unit is right after theirs.
What's another way we can link it into the larger picture?
I do like the river water evaporating, so we could do maybe summer versus winter, or you know, different.
I think what she's saying is the bucket, and then the crater's here, but the paper's over here.
Yeah.
Like that. Yeah, that would work too. That's a good idea. Like that.
Do you want to collect data on?
Okay.
I mean, you can double any of these.
Sure.
These are just the basic six.
Okay.
Why don't you put that in the appendix? I write variables for lab stations in parentheses. If need more than six groups, double up any variable.
Okay. Yeah.
I know.
You can put if need. That sounds more curriculum, more science-y. More than six groups needed.
Does that match what you have?
No, only because... Maybe this.
You know what?
I didn't write all the little...
Change the height of object drops. In parentheses there,
I make sure
and I put half students be rows. Because you don't want kids going all the way to the ceiling.
So what I was going to take out is how will the impact affect me? I'm going to take that out. There was also gravity, how gravity is a part of it. So that's when, how does gravity play a part in it to maintain our surface? I'm not even talking, we're going to get rid of it. So that's out. That's just one of the main functions.
So if you put the asteroid over the topo map, saying you can explain all their extinct, to life on Earth, explain what's heat is, because if they're doing the climate change, because this article does talk about fossil record and that is what's going to be extinct, how the extinction occurred, volcanoes crashing, shifting continents, I think we have to cite that.
because that's the page is citing the
science.
Okay. Well, yeah.
And then the other part
of
that gravity is how are we doing that part?
Feeling it. They actually track the dorsal lines. Yeah. So they can do that. I mean, they can take that and then it goes down a little bit. You have the results that look down.
And then we go into understanding why would this password even track in the first place? They're still getting into the side of physics.
That's where it is.
From the evidence, okay, we have these craters, we have evidence, the fossil record on the. Okay, well, how did this asteroid hit the why did it impact us? Why did it
fly
out of space?
System apparently. So they have like a stake in trying to get everybody to switch to it because they invented it.
Preferably.
The online classes room, they're not using classes.
We're going to switch over to Canvas. All of our support. So, and like my classes are in person, but I have a website for all, you know, for all the, you know, it's still web enhanced, right? So now I'm going to have to do that.
So, David, do you want to work on the extend?
Sure.
Whatever. One of us should work with Adrian on evaluate, and one of us should work on extend. Or do you want me to work on the rubric? I'm starting to. I took the initiation
or the comes from the web, gets swooped in, and gets caught by the rubric. So, and then we looked at some structure examples.
Do you guys want to work on the other parts? And
do you want to help me think of what the end product is? So I said they're going to do some math, preferably using ArcGIS.
Almost killed themselves. Luckily, they sent me an email. We got but the bottom line is, I tell my students, like, I won't put your grades on Blackboard or any of these online places at this point. I'll turn back your test and come see me. And,
Hi.
And I don't think you can do that.
But if you're teaching online, we have to choose.
You have to design
or
design.
announcements or redesign the area, or if they're going to have to provide a plan to redesign.
Kind of tying the two, because we can have two of the core ideas where we're kind of blending how do we connect the cells with the structure and function of organism. Right. So we could still fall under inheritance. We could still have a surgical lesson. But before that or after that would be the genetics element of the lesions of tolerance.
And so, they see everything I wrote, they can hear my voice. They don't have like my
voice. The question is, where do they go? Is it going to be at the beginning of the hook? Or should the practice of tolerance be
that?
Because it's
they can have his goal for 200 bucks a month.
They always remind me of my materials. Or leather silver.
Right.
Did you hear, by the way, that Pokemon Go, this new app?
Yes.
Oh, God.
They were getting nailed, though, because two of the places they put on where people are going to go look for their Pokemon, one is the Holocaust Museum.
Who's now said, please take us off.
And the other one is like 9/11 Museum.
Wow.
And so people are like, it's all Sama Go, and look, I got Pikachu.
Yeah, if you're like going to like, you know, the Vietnam War Memorial and like chasing Pokemon.
Yes.
It's like totally disrespectful.
Yeah, you're
disrespectful.
In Arlington, you're like running around trying to snap Pokemon.
Out of someone's grave, yeah. I mean, it's like really disrespectful. So obviously, the programmers are saying they've got it like programmed off someplace. One of the professors was saying yesterday he's teaching summer at Southwestern, and this week Monday, students came into his classroom trying to find a Pokemon in the middle of his class.
Really?
Yeah. Walked into his classroom looking for a Pokemon. No, that was on Monday. So that means Southwestern. So they're on your. It's on in the. In, yeah.
Tuesday. I'm gonna get up and run outside. That's a Pokemon.
He keeps playing the Pokemon.
Yeah.
You found one on campus, right?
No, I didn't.
Oh, I thought you did.
Well, I think all of at least high schools are off the map.
But they didn't. But like we were saying yesterday, they didn't take like the Holocaust Museum and stuff off, or like war memorials.
Yeah,
I'm about to go through Arlington Cemetery trying to
find it.
To find out how certain ecosystems are going to be impacted by sea level rise, and the students use engineering to design a way of mitigating. Yeah, and that's it. And then
you'd be like, we looked at the cardiovascular system and the engineering model heart models. And
I wouldn't do any extra work. I know.
So many of us.
Middle schoolers probably will.
Yeah, well, but some of them, there's like two people in the group and they haven't even as they can really drop down and drill down into their lessons.
Yeah.
Us, there's just no way this is going to happen.
No.
We've got like 10 different designs kind of going on.
So
no matter how we end up breaking these things apart.
And I think, hey, if you guys can't, because I don't know if you can finish all of them. I don't know how you guys do that. But if you can't, just finish one. I would just finish one. And then the other ones you can always use and work on, but I would leave them there. But have one that we can
start with. Watch the flush the submission.
With everybody's
data. If you have all three done, they're all just awesome. Because they pay money. They how do you pay things? There's a lot of, once you feel the
plot, it's
a lot of, somewhere in the building.
That's cool.
Well,
theirs are so designed. I got the hard part jumping in the hand part.
Is Del Rey?
Because it's all the
house.
Are they getting a lot of stuff from house feet? That's great. Yeah. I mean, I think it's fine either way.
The hand, they found the Lego model.
You first saw that hand kit?
Or the opposite.
Yeah,
well, any parent, that's what I'm talking about.
No, not yet.
I was going to, but
they wanted to do that. So, they're going to provide a response plan.
I'm not, but at some point we'll also do
should they also,
where it's sort of,
I'm not saying words, I got
it. And then talk about, well, what we're going to do is, like, a person that's going to make a project, and they talk about what would have to happen for the lower slope rise to happen, like, say, if we don't want, if we only want it to rise to 5 feet, we have to say how, so basically they're making a climate action plan.
Yes.
Climate action plan.
Correct.
I like that better, the climate action plan better. I'm putting mitigation, so I'm going to change my
mind.
So yeah, make sure you've got it.
Okay.
I was thinking about it. I think I put
stories from around the world.
I put
they got one day I got all that. I fixed one of the stuff on my
So it's
for building the tower, so we try to build the biggest tower, and then when you debrief that, what do you say? There's only
now we have to
so high you can get. What's the idea behind the tower and the intro to this?
That was the engineering, right?
Yeah, it was kind of an engineering. Figure we're kind of beginning the year, group building. And
oh, it's a group building?
Icebreaker.
Okay.
It's actually linked. It's a live link. It'll take you right to it, the actual thing we did. But then also, then we can kind of talk about, like, I mean, I don't know about your kids. Well, I know my kids. Half of them don't believe me when I try to tell them how big Sequoia is. You know?
Right, talk about Sequoia.
So if we show them some of the big trees and stuff, we'd be like, hey, you want a tower? What's the problem? You know, what taller we got? You know,
it's also to introduce them to the design process.
Okay,
because in the beginning of the year,
engineering design process,
and be able to elaborate on the design. Why did you choose
what
they want?
This approach.
Yeah. Did you try
then,
or like, you know?
Could you look at the extent of the help plans?
Maybe, if I can remember how to read.
Then we go in. There's a plant gizmos. The way it is. Too much
activity. No, why don't you start growing plants? And then, like, every day.
And that was the part Gina was talking about. Also, the question
on board, but
the impact of the speed on
it.
So then we can visit. What do we do with plant gizmos?
It's a.
Yeah, I'd rather just do it this way.
Oh, okay.
Rather than go here, go there.
It's called plant growth. Is it plants
or plant growth?
Growing
plants. Yeah.
Growing plants.
Gizmos.
Okay. And so then they'll be able to do that, and then start growing the plants.
Yeah. In a way, the evaluate almost mixes with the extent.
Oh,
yeah. So, yeah.
And on the gizmos,
right.
They alter
right
the soil and the water and all that stuff.
So they're going to kind of then design their own experiment. What they think would be the best way to do it. And then
groups of four?
Yeah. Probably 10. Draws like 3 or 4.
Oh, and that's the executive side of that. You're getting everybody trained.
Okay, or how about these kids? Can I have groups of 5?
Yeah. What about 7?
Yeah. I always have to come up with something like, okay, but you lose points.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, over 5, but that's why I start adding.
Right. So groups of 4. How about 7?
Yeah.
I'm like, okay, but you're going to need 2 C's and 2 separate
problems. Okay. Yeah, that's it. Yeah. I got okay. Groups of 5. Yeah, 2 plus.
Yeah. You each have to fill out your own. You know, the
film festival and travel.
Right.
We got a deal. So then I got that.
And somebody's there.
Plant some seeds. Who wants to grow the tallest?
Oh, we're going to show them. We're going to try and find the video for the engineer in Martian. Where Matt Damon is trying to grow plants. But we try to find a clip right now, and it's hard because YouTube and things are blocked. So we're not getting through.
All right. So it's out there somewhere. We'll find a picture.
Yeah.
I'll be the marshal.
You know when you start.
Yeah, I'll
try to. How about anybody have experience with
because you know how Kim had.
Biodome? The movie Biodome? I've never seen it, but I know there's an account of the actual Biodome, people that lived in it.
You know what? I've been in
Arizona. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm going to research Biodome. See how that
went. Are we talking about, like, there's a David Attenborough clip on Planet Earth, Jungles, and that talks about, like, rainforests and the giant trees.
Oh, David
Attenborough. So we thought about showing that. And then kind of this is like our first kind of, we're talking about like
second
to Midtown, and then we might have
that's how it started. Something that's easy for them to
do.
Or they
could
even.
He's outside of
Boston. Yeah, right. So that all the groups have like equal starting materials.
Could do that. So they start off with the same amount of materials. For the laws. The
laws are constant.
So this is the materials that we have, because not every group, let's say, they represent a country.
No, that was too boring.
If you want to make it global, or you can make it global either one. So, food train stars, netting, streamers, funnels, plastic ziplocs.
For a James Beard? Oh, culinary?
I'm going to put glue.
Yeah, it'd be kind of cool. But he didn't make it to the final.
Strings?
Yeah.
Without coloring.
I don't know.
Because there are some that is.
Oh, yeah.
It's hard to find string without that coloring.
Should we say what they're going to construct, though? I think we need to say what they're going to construct.
That you cook out of, that you only use the disposable ones.
Okay, so do you want to look at the river?
So that is your love. Yeah.
And
that is awesome.
Water.
So, for mastery, I put for the conceptual understanding.
And then, if you want, I mean, water is clear, but you can use food coloring. So that they can see the contrast.
If I may ask, you know, can you guys give a little like review or something of what you guys are discussing about? So we can pick it up in that camera. Like,
So you want to know what we're doing right now?
Yeah, like what we'll be doing for.
Okay.
Sure. So right now we're trying to have the students design like a trash collecting device for the Pacific Ocean garbage patch. So we'll give the students some materials to design the most cost-effective device that can collect the trash found dispersed throughout the Pacific Ocean.
We're not getting anywhere right now. We're having a great discussion.
Sorry, it's all good.
You know what you can do is a trick kind of saw kids work. If you get some of the white sage, you crush it, you get like a little clip and put it on your vent in your car, and you turn it on the vent, you get like a natural air freshener.
My wife's told us that she was falling for that for a while, so like she gets like the sage
bundles. Burns it?
Oh yeah.
Purifies it.
When her brother died a couple years ago, one of his friends is native from Nevada. He brought us, it's a red apple shell. That you burn those sage and then it actually gives a fan
mail.
So we got that house and so yeah, sage dollars. You're smoking patchouli and sage all the time.
I just bought patchouli essential oil for diffuse or whatever.
Yeah.
And then we just smudged my house like 2 days ago.
Oh, you did?
Yeah. Well, I'm white, so
Not my wife. My wife's got asthma enough.
That's what my son says. Like, I'll cough it.
My wife, nothing smoking.
Yeah, we're all smoking.
She's like, no. I tried to burn incense or whatever.
She traveled around.
Wow. I don't know. She was on the bus.
Oh, wow. Yeah, she had a school bus.
Yeah.
The school bus, they followed.
Have you ever read the book, The Electric Silly Incident?
Oh, yeah.
That's about a band of people that followed the Grateful Dead, and they were all they're trying to film it.
Oh, wow.
They're trying to make a movie. The movie was horrible because they're not on. They were horrible at producing.
In theory, it was great. No,
yeah. So when you start talking about that, they say you're either on the bus or you're off the bus.
If you're on the bus, you're sitting. No, you're not. They say on tour. Yeah. She's like, oh, yeah. So the last 15 years, I've been 16 years Saturday, so 16 years that played here, of course. And her brother was quite a broke his neck, jumping off on Delta's Punch Bowl. So he's in his wheelchair, so I drive his van. I park him, and we're like, tailgate. So we have a little barbecue out there, and there's chicken, and all this stuff. Going away.
Don't film this.
Don't film this. Time out.
So
don't be cut. Don't worry.
I'm doing all this stuff. I looked over my shoulder, and there's a couple of people standing.
Because that's not the main.
It's like content. You have the content knowledge.
Yeah, it looks so charged.
Plans for each day of the unit. Because really, like, that's, I think, what the goal is at the end, like, at the end of the year, you know, that we would have this done.
Right.
But I started to kind of go through.
Well, I just found this neat article.
And think about, like, those activities
for
each day. So, like, on the
heat and it was, it's a whole day. And I do
specifically remember what that was, but it's all in there.
Like,
maybe
just put, like, a little comment underneath. Yeah, well, also, I like it so much because
it's
because,
you know, so, and it's like, identify, put a little asterisk on the intermolecular force. Okay, so that's like, okay, in relation to the molecule, where are these intermolecular forces, inside or outside? So it starts off really, all right, are you kidding me? This is kind of lame, is the way it's starting. But
right.
Then
so then it's
going like,
to be,
okay, well,
so maybe instead of day one, we should be saying lesson one.
It's kind of interesting how they just, like, they're random and they're not pretty.
And then it might be where you, and I'm quick. I can get a lot done in an hour.
Questions about that.
That's great.
The difference between
the two
and
I'm always like,
I like
don't get it. Dang it!
Because it forced us to do that this year.
You know,
occasionally that. I think it's just for the bus periods to do that too, but it's only at the end of every bus period. It's not,
you're
not
like an hour.
He's still like, all,
like
almost everything
that
an hour part
of
the bus has, but like, he still talks to her.
In fact,
and like, he said she was getting the door, and he
really
really
talks
about
to her
and
a lot.
And we're gonna vote on.
Still talks about her.
And talks
like,
but.
She is a
strategic.
Yeah,
I'm not criticizing that.
Yeah,
this.
But he sure kept it.
Like mediated instruction. So the goal was
she probably gave
me
the idea.
Once a day, you would have extra hour with one of your classes.
Awesome.
So like maybe Monday you have an extra hour with first
awesome
period. Tuesday you have an extra hour with the second period.
Like,
there's one or Wednesday of an extra hour with third period. During that extra hour is when students who completely get it, right? You don't need to keep them. Like whatever those 5 to 10
so
students in your class could go to the quad and do activities, which the other students you would keep
them,
they'd be doing test corrections or
anyway,
so then a small group to work on.
When I'd
be there,
they all had to
stay. But then the teacher started being like, whatever, I get an extra hour, so they would send all their kids.
But the printer
and then
they had this like
fiasco that wasn't being used for what it was supposed to be used for. So then they need to keep all of your. So then you have like all of your first period, which some of the teachers like, I guess pretty good being like there's like all of your projects, so you're working on that project during this hour, and then the other kids I would do whatever to test correction and stuff with, but then.
No,
no,
we are.
Some of the students would have
in the
5 hours. Some teachers just sort of talk through it.
Yeah.
So depending on, yeah.
So the bathroom breaks.
So it was,
usually
mean, we have a very like a tutorial period built into our block day.
I think
that
we could do our
paperclip
clip
you know, like
first.
Well, 2 days, but we're going to do our paper clip for an extra half hour.
And that's
when we get
so just because I want to use it and I'm water.
Oh, no, yeah, because I had those two. Yeah,
absolutely. Then what can I do to
we have
passwords.
You just have to get
paper clips.
Melanie, yeah.
By adding,
let's get on topic.
So basically, we're there to
an hour to try to get the surface tension, and then we'll have a little bit of feedback from them, put some final touches on the word.
And we're going
to
introduce that.
The nice thing is we can listen to
and actually do it based on this lesson. Because if you look at like what an emerging or approaching developing mastery, even a developing one says, explains the science behind why the scenarios work, but is missing some key points in the explanation. So like, we can actually,
okay, so lesson number one.
Hopefully just through this, they should be able to get that far.
Well, even if they don't explain it with accuracy, though, it's okay.
Yes.
It's perfectly okay because we have a partner, the bonding formation.
This is the first day, presumably, of
just to give them, yeah.
And it's before Ionic incubator.
I know.
That's true.
I
wasn't there when they decided to change that.
Now, do they have they covered periodic transits?
Yes.
Yes. Electronegativity?
Yeah. Yes.
We are going to. No,
I mean, we
can when we do covalent, right? But
is like
it's going to be covered yet. This time first.
I have to talk about polar bonds without talking.
Like,
I know.
Yeah,
electronegativity, what I always tell the kids, I'm like, okay,
yeah,
when we're dealing with atomic structure, you know, and we finish up the unit with trends in the periodic table, I said, think of this Venn diagram, because here comes the next unit. Because I can't really talk about electronegativity without talking about polarity, and molecules is the next unit. And so that's always the end of my unit, and it's a perfect segue.
And the polar bonds are what close the interdimensional.
Exactly, but that's kind of an introduction.
Yeah, we're not there yet.
And I'd like
this different approach.
It might be
good.
I'm trying to think of
a
line.
Because then it's like a black box, like a magnet.
Or would that be the
engagement?
Or
like
these. Wait, so are you saying that we need to teach it?
You can expose them, but in the process, you have to teach that so they understand what's going on.
We will, but not
yet.
It's not like this is their first science class they've ever had. Just by listening to their understanding,
don't drink the water.
From them about what did you learn about middle school science?
But I think that's enough.
They learn the difference between
ionic
and covalent.
I think on a few different
occasions, they would say, "Oh yeah, covalent means sharing."
They
know that coming. They know that ions. They know what ions are. That there was, a gain or a loss of electrons. They know what ions are, and so it would only be a matter of time.
At least, like on here, what we have is like, what is energy?
So you know what
types of energy,
conservation
of
energy,
energy
transfer. You can say, and metals lose electrons, non-metals gain electrons. So what is an ionic form?
We don't have the different parts of their.
You know,
we
could informally have a discussion.
Apparently, yeah.
A Rube Goldberg thing would be great for an engagement.
I'm going
to
have to.
Say a marble at the top, that's potential stored energy.
And
so you've got a mouse trap at some point,
too,
that's potential stored energy.
And if it goes horribly wrong, then at least
we
know what not to do.
So is it?
Oh, yeah.
This comes back to
so much room
at
the same time.
Yeah. So this would be.
You know what? It depends on how you control the whole thing. Like, you don't go, you just have to let them. Discover that there is kind of force that holds between molecules.
This is what I did last
That's
year.
It. And then their mind starts to inquire for more. Like,
right, but the point is go back a step before that. Is they at this point the way the standards are written for this year? Were you at that industry meeting? I wasn't there, and I wasn't part of the discussion that said we're going to do intermolecular forces before ionic and covalent.
That's
what energy is, right?
And maybe, like,
no,
we're trying to get
at
talking
about
the idea that
there
are different types of energy
and
transfer.
That leads
to
the discussion
of
the
Goldberg,
right? The transfer of energy.
Yeah.
It seems so difficult, though.
So
but I think the point is this, that We let them observe
phenomena. Wait, so is this in supposed to be an IMF light, or is this going to be an IMF?
This is IMF field, but this is like introduction.
Okay, so that's where I was thinking it also.
So this is serving kind of as the
bridge. We're going to do IMF light at the beginning of the year, which I'm still.
I know.
I haven't embraced that yet. And then, and I think that maybe where surface tension and viscosity might actually be.
Yeah. Because remember, Ryan, were you there? We were talking about properties.
Yes. Before the next one.
So if they're talking about force, we can have a plus or minus a track.
Plus, plus. So what we're going over here, this is stuff that they can
adjust that.
And some other object.
Okay, just that. I could do just that.
Yeah, because that's the whole, that's everything. We that's why I'm at this Coulomb's interactions.
Are they all the same temperature?
But that's not what we're doing right now. I understand that there is a lot more science behind it, but what we're trying to do first is things that they could see first. And then we're going from, okay, they know surface tension, they know these things. Then we're going to teach them about everything underneath.
They did get that in high school. They know that coming in.
Okay.
So I think
we might have to remind them that they know it.
Maybe like, in, and
then
we
do a lot of that.
And we do this lesson, and then maybe several days later we get into Coulomb's law. But
no, Coulomb's law is not part of regular or honors chemistry.
Well,
we
no,
don't,
I'm just saying,
don't
like,
use college.
Right.
Now we're learning
you,
Coulomb's law. We talk about it. But Coulomb's law is an AP chemistry. It's not an honors.
I mentioned that in my regular.
You do?
Mm-hmm.
Overwhelmed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then,
mention is not.
And then what's really important is the epsilon in the denominator, which is the dielectric constant. So actually, water has one of the largest dielectric constants.
Yeah.
So
I'm
there
from the Main Street.
You got to meet them where they're at.
Yes, they will get to college one day, and then they get going into all that stuff. But for now, they're teenage. They don't have a prefrontal cortex yet.
They do have a prefrontal cortex.
It's full of Doritos and Mountain Dew. And we need to shape that into something.
It is just to stir up their minds. Seeing this phenomenon and what's the science behind it. It's just letting them have that
Taz and Kyle
mind
going
so and they're showing a remote learning machine.
To the level of
so we could either do it where we explore,
put labels on,
your computer
on the
fridge.
But,
oh no, my computer
is
dead.
And the labels
on
the
right. Well, I was going to ask because that is EMF.
Yeah, my
but
focus.
They don't know that yet. we know you know that, and we know that that's what science knows. But these high schools don't know that yet.
We want to say something special for them to come to do.
Like properties of matter.
Yeah.
The very, very beginning of the unit.
We
focus on properties and then go into the structure. But they would never get to understand properties unless they see phenomena.
Yeah, don't forget this. We're talking about regular chemistry class.
Yeah,
we're talking
exactly.
About, and the students may or may not
very
really
rough.
Belong.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I understand. Yeah. I remember having long conversations with Steve Roder here about.
Okay, so
I miss Steve.
Okay, so here's what we have.
What are you typing away, darling?
Everything. So here's what we have.
Awesome.
Okay, so here's what we have for
our lesson is all typed up. I don't know about you guys over there.
Well, a lot of it we stole from Rach. Okay, so here's what they'll be doing for the
Again,
water striders and water. Can I edit
so
this?
Go crazy.
I'm
just
saying that.
I just downloaded
it. So, in the past,
wait, is it a Word document?
I
yes.
First talk about temperature.
Oh, wait, the.
Because
that's
how energy is transferred from whatever is warmed or whatever is colder.
I need to edit the header. Not just this thing.
So, I don't do phase. So, yeah, I moved around lessons 3 and 4. I think we had them flipped. Like, we first were talking about phase changes, but in
you know what, son?
You guys are very. You guys are wonderful people to work with.
Where they take, just to kind of get them all in the same changes.
Really?
hot water and cold water, and they find their temperatures,
and
then they mix them together and find the temperature, and it's like, duh, you know, like kind of thing, but just to get them on the same page to kind of see what happens at the macro level and then try to have them model
what's going on at the molecular level, right? So that's kind of their initial model. So it's again another time to model for them to like see what's going on. And a lot of them don't quite get at like the idea of like, how the energies
become
the warm to the cold. And then by starting with that model later on, we can come back to it.
Calorimetry even before any phase change.
Yeah, USD.
So yeah, okay, so the
energy transfer, that all kind of goes hand in hand.
Yeah, so that might even feel good. And again, I like open to moving things around, but like just having them do different
how that fits into their conceptual understanding. Okay. So like basically it's kind of getting them at kinetic energy, right? The understanding of the particles. So maybe, I wonder if we can put that in that explore section, like if we're having them do hot water and cold water, mixing them together, kind of seeing what's going on. But if we had them add some food coloring to it, then maybe it'll be better to visual what's going on with the food coloring. And then when they mix them together, I don't, like I, if you have whatever,
it's
red and yellow,
thinking.
And they're mixing them together, and then they can see how the color's changing also, so maybe it'll be a better visual of how they're mixing together.
Maybe, but, because I don't know, like, I think, I thought about that too, but I think I would stick with one color food coloring, because I wouldn't want them to think that, like, that food coloring being able to spread through it at different rates is because of the different color. Like, I would want them to see this was the same food coloring, but only
temperature.
Yeah, just think if it would get a better visual.
Can you really see the difference? I mean, is it an obvious difference with the food coloring? And you're using, like, how cold is cold water?
I just use straight out of the tap.
Okay, so use tap water and, like,
and then I heat it up on a hot plate short of boiling.
Yeah, gotcha.
And then just one drop each, and then we just watch. So I'm going to keep it cold first, and then the hot second, and then side by side, and then
taking a lot of stuff
hot
out
just goes, and the cold just kind of sinks to the bottom,
more.
And then doesn't really do much.
That's
okay.
Right.
So
I'm doing tables too. If I practice for table tables, it'd be easy for them to create a day table
for
that.
And we don't
want to. So do you want to time it in, or is it not?
Conclusion, since the way we've got it formatted, I'm not going to say do it on the back of this paper.
I mean, just do it on this on the sheet, or even on a separate sheet of paper.
No, we're going to just do it.
You can even hear it. I
talked
to them about, like, you know how you
can
hear when water's going to boil?
They're
like, what? And the girls are like, uh-huh. You know, like,
I can't see them.
That's because water molecules are moving around. They're crashing into the side of the pot. Hmm. I never thought about that. It only lasts about 5 minutes. So then they're able to see not only speeding up the reaction, but they using
but
the
you know,
so it might not be such a quick splash.
The website,
mycid.com.
So they're really bright, really short.
Yeah, super bright.
So how many days from this? So this is step four. Step three is like, it's this and... This is like where each of us gets to do it differently because it's our highest
score.
So for we are presenting for a little bit there. We're going to use POGO intro.
I think I would do Hess's law.
But if you had to pass, like you had your notes,
yeah, 2 days.
Or we could throw in there.
But I think I'm going to do chemical reactions more.
So
I think I'll go into more of a
discussion.
Yeah,
I'm going to do Hess's law. Do you want to do a vocabulary?
I would.
So what if we do like a little full?
I don't know if I'll really talk about Hess's law.
Okay, so I'll,
so this is all still part of the experiment. So, as part of the experiment.
A hole for the thermometers.
Yeah. Oh, that's big enough.
Yeah. In the middle? Yeah.
What's
we're putting it in the middle.
Oh, and the ground machine passed. I know in our school, only there's only like 8 cancer markets. Like 5 stories.
I'll just spend some time hard and build that. It's probably just here so I can replace my broken ones. But I'll always get some more.
Yeah, well, and the alcohol separates so easily inside of those things. It's really long and
I'm so excited to get my probe. I really hope that it happens.
It's not clear if and when it will show up.
You need to get like 20 temperature probes, though, if you're going to have 10 lab groups and you're going to have 2 thermometers each.
I only have 6 lab groups.
Yeah.
But if I divide that in half, which I sometimes do, it'll start to be less.
She's got a small class.
Okay. She must count lots of students.
We're waiting for ice cubes to come back so we can do our next experiment.
Oh, cool. All
right, so here we go.
Do you have any? No. The first law of thermodynamics. Heat is work and work is heat. Your turn.
We have
heat is work and work is heat.
The second law.
Wait, are we actually going to do that in our presentation?
No. Well, okay, they wanted us to do something that is work and work is heat. Your turn.
Heat is work and work is heat.
The second law of thermodynamics. Heat cannot of itself pass from one body to a hotter body.
Heat
won't pass from a cooler to a hotter.
Heat won't pass from a cooler to a hotter.
You can try it if you like, but you far better not.
You can try it if you like, but you far better not.
Because the cold in the cooler will get hotter as a ruler.
We try it with ice.
Because the hotter body's heat will pass to it and work. But the curse and all the heat in
no
the
way,
curse
this way colder.
Is cool down.
Why don't you try it?
Because it can't increase. Then there'll be no more work, and there'll be perfect peace.
Really?
Feel that whisper. That's edgy. Whisper feels cooler. Okay. Which one feels colder?
Block B.
Does block B feel colder to you too?
Yes.
So that would be cool. I want those IR thermometers. So I have two pieces of ice. And the students will always say it's going to melt faster on the one that felt warmer.
You always have that one student that's like, I don't trust you anymore because you've been wrong every other day. And it's just like, it's going to be cold.
I didn't realize it was going to melt that fast. That's great.
It melts way faster.
Mr. Bishop,
on the
is this
going to
be another one of those physics experiments that doesn't work?
If it's biology, it's dead. And if it's chemistry, it stinks. And if it's physics, it doesn't always work.
Yes.
Actually,
okay, that's weird. Here, let's. Maybe that's just like a fast melting ice cube. Let's go ahead and switch them.
Actually, my face saying is, if it's dead, it's biology. If it's.
It's like really, really cold.
What are the two materials?
No idea.
One's aluminum, and the other is wood. Or some of it use foam, like a hard foam board.
Nice. Yeah.
This is great.
Now at this point they're dying to know why it's happening.
Yes.
Some point that it's, they say, okay, it can't be the temperature.
Yeah,
some will
go
there.
It's definitely colder.
Yeah, because the cold one is melting faster. So some will go to the, what is it made out of? But some won't get there. They won't get there. They will refuse to think too hard about it because they just want the answer. So
yes.
That's the hard part, is getting them to think beyond, well, if it's not the temperature, I don't know. I don't know.
Well, we can tell everyone today that we're just not going to tell them.
I typically tell my students, I'm like, we're not going to, what if I do this as a hook for this lesson, I will be like, okay, guys, we're going to go in a little deeper to how heat travels and how that energy is transferred, because that's what's going on here. The energy in both situations is being transferred from the block to the ice cube. In both situations, because the ice is melting. In both of them. They're both endothermic. They're both all of that.
Virtually now it's dripping, so to avoid a slip, I'm going to move this.
Okay, go ahead. They're both endothermic. It's just transferring at different rates. So we're going to look at how that heat energy transfers in this lab that we're going to do. And then they go on into the lab.
Cool.